Hello. It's very good to be here, and it's very meaningful to me. Ever since last year's Audi event, I have been speaking very positively about Audi and the feelings for the company, because it's a lot like it takes me back in my own life to starting Apple Computer. Where did we go from an age of huge computers and companies to little, small, personally owned machines? But when I was in high school, and this was an age where we had no computers in our schools, there were no books on how to design computers in bookstores. There were no magazines about computers. I went to the technical bookstores and couldn't find anything, but I knew that I loved computers from a little bit of information I'd had and projects that I'd built for science fairs and that like. So I told my father, someday I am going to own my own 4K mini computer. It's a big computer. It looked like this, and it had switches and lights for ones and zeros. The old geeky, you had to understand what every button you pushed did to operate this thing. I'm going to own one. My father said it costs as much as a house, so I said I'll live in an apartment. I desperately wanted a computer. I was shy. I wasn't very social, but man, I understood how computers worked, and that was important to me. We made a quick little computer that I had converted. I'd taken it down to the Homebrew Computer Club. I had shared my design for free. I gave my design away for free because I wanted to help the revolution get started. And then, before we ever shipped one of those things called the Apple I, I designed the Apple II computer. This was going to revolutionize the world. This was going to bring computers forever to the world. Small computers were going to be a big thing. This machine, out of the box, easy to use, good instructions. We priced it high. We priced it high because we wanted to grow a company and not keep borrowing money. We wanted to do it on our own. And the Apple II computer, a lot of people don't realize, was the first time ever that arcade games, ones you play with knobs and dials and all that, first time ever they would be color. You know, a lot of things you challenge are almost impossible. I was very, very lucky in my life to be in a period of my life where just what was pouring out of my brain, I just knew how to do a certain kind of digital design that applied to computers. I had taught myself my entire life how to do that kind of designing, and it turned out to be important at a certain point in time. Never bypass the factor of luck. If you do things at the right time and the world starts moving your way, if you do it 2 years later, 3 years later, 4 years later, it's too late to really be a big player in the game. Ask Nokia, ask BlackBerry. So that's a lot of it. Steve Jobs himself wanted to be important. So when we got funded for my Apple II computer, the big game playing computer, Steve was now founder of a company that had big money put in. Big money. That's what he wanted his whole life, a way to be someone important. And then he started trying to espouse his ideas. He was still learning. He really didn't have experience. He didn't understand the insides of computers, but he was using his mind to start to understand and explain to people how you could use computers. He was a great salesman, a great marketer. And as things went on, he tried to prove that he had a mind that could create new computers, but he kept having failures until a point in time when he returned from Apple. And his first real success in business terms, the iPod. The iPod opened up to Windows users as well as Mac users, and the iPod was a music device. Everyone wants music. It wasn't a computer. It was just for you to get music, and it took away every computer term you could think of. Plug in your computer, you have songs. You have songs, not files. And that was the way he had thought his whole life. Steve Jobs, his limited experience with computers were sit on a terminal, and the real computers are far away, somewhere out there on timesharing, it was called. Today, what do we have? Your real computers are out in the cloud. And you're just sort of visualizing what they're telling you is the best results of what they can gather from all the data on the internet. So really, Steve Jobs' background was right for the future we wound up in. A lot of that you can't predict. People and companies, we had projects, and you always hire people with the right skill set. That's why Apple would probably not hire me today or Steve Jobs where we were. You know. But the funny thing is, a lot of times it matters is personality. Getting a group of people whose personalities work together, and you're much happier in your job and you work a lot better. And that applies to you and your partners here at Audi. So now, as far as automobile self-driving, one of the things is you want to reduce accidents. You want to make driving safer all the time. So cars, one of the things is a car can be trained and look at the red lights and look at the stop signs and just drive by the rules, but it can also watch all the cars that are coming from the sides with a camera. But if we have electronic communication between them, it'll be even better. There was once a study done with airplanes that if airplanes flew, they could have these radars and all this software and computers controlling everything and looking out for planes that might be in a collision. But if you put a small little inexpensive device on every plane that talked to every other plane, they would actually solve the problem better, they would have fewer accidents, and it was less expensive. Of course, the world went with the more expensive air traffic controlled approach. So, but this is, obviously, this is the big thing that's coming up in the future more and more. As more and more companies get into more electronic assistant cars, particularly, but now, you know, we're talking about cars and scooters, trains, all the different forms of transportation all working together. And I haven't thought about that a lot yet, but it's obviously going to be a bigger issue in the past than it has been, in the future than it has been in the past. First of all, it's not just an idea in your head that'll make an innovation. That's one of the starts. You got to have an inspiration. You have to want to do it. You need marketing. And the best marketing of all is if you want something yourself to use. Not if I analyze all the sheets and I estimate how people are thinking. If I want it, I always know exactly what's right. And if you put this extra little thing, it's wrong. Look at Steve Jobs and the iPhone. Meticulous about every little feature on it so it didn't get cumbersome and overloaded and difficult to use for a normal person. You need good marketing and you need business sense.
So can we all thank Steve for taking the time out of his schedule today to speak with us? Thank you very much.